Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. This is a live feed from Vaughan's front lawn through his CCTV cameras. He's been telling me for the last 3 days he's got, what are these called? Zebra on somewhere in his grounds, but I haven't seen them yet. So we've now got a picture of them. And I'm going to stick with the theme of animals through the course of this talk. I'm going to talk later on about the Jungle Book, and I'm going to talk about cats and dogs, but more of that later. Let me start by expressing my enormous gratitude to Vaughan, his wife Jackie, and all of the team at MDA for their enormous and generous hospitality. And by way of a small gesture of thanks, can I hand to Vaughan a signed copy of the book that he's kindly done the publicity of?
Thank you very much.
There's no need for me to repeat what he said about the discount kindly offered by my publishers, who generally covered themselves in glory, save for the fact that when the first proofs came back, they changed the name. They changed it to Delay and Destruction in Construction Contracts. I'm not sure whether they did it on purpose to see how far I could be wound up, but it certainly had a great impression. But thinking about it, actually, destruction is quite an apt and appropriate word, because disputes about delay and disruption are so prevalent and cause so much destruction to relationships and to the industry that we should all do our utmost to make sure we avoid them. And what I'm going to try to do today is not just talk about the bad news, but also to look forward, hopefully, to some better news and to consider ways in which destruction can be avoided. So, thinking about what Watson, Vaughan's driver, was telling me about this morning when he was coaching me in Afrikaans, Damus en Heren, reminds me of a tall story about an American executive who went to Moscow to deliver a hugely important speech to a symposium. And he was met at the airport by the driver, not Watson, and the interpreter, not Watson. And he was taken to the hotel where the symposium was being held. And on the way into the conference, he went to the loo. And he saw the names above the restrooms. And he asked his interpreter to pronounce those words for him. And so when he got up to make his speech, he started by saying the names over the restroom. And the entire audience fell apart laughing. Got to the end of the speech, loud acclaim. And he went to those who had invited him and he said, why were they laughing when I said ladies and gentlemen? And he said, well, actually, what you said was urinals and toilets. And so there's always a serious side to jokes and to lessons that we can learn. And what Ewan was talking about before the coffee break was the importance of words. And I'm going to come back to that as a theme as well when I return to the cats and dogs. My instructions from Vaughan are to speak for 1 to 1.5 hours, and I'm conscious that we are up against the lunch break. So I'm probably going to terminate it a little earlier than that. And what I wanted to do was to talk about some other Bibles. And this was the Bible that I read on my Turkish Airlines flight to Istanbul and then down to O.R. Tambo. And this is what it says about speeches. An after-dinner speech should be like a lady's dress, long enough to cover the subject and short enough to be interesting. That's R.A. Butler. And Pat O'Malley, Lord knows who he is, had this to say, and it's probably related to the first of those references. Speeches are like babies, easy to conceive, hard to deliver. So, I picked up the Times this morning. Let me do my job. That's your finance minister, who still appears to be in a job, although perhaps not for that long. What's my job? My job is to tell you a little bit about my experience of cases involving delay and disruption on major infrastructure projects. And this comes from the background of over 30 years at Atkin Chambers in Gray's Inn, where I left on the 31st of May to join RDB Chambers for my third-party neutral work. And on Independence Day, I joined Silver Shemmings in London to do my council work. And let's start with some attempted definitions. In the book that I've just given to Vaughan, I devote the first chapter to trying to define the words that I'll be using. And delay and disruption don't have intrinsic qualities in themselves. They are relative, they're related to the context in which they're used. They're related to delay to a completion date, a delaying impact upon that completion date. And so what we're really looking at is the C word, causation. And that, time and time again, is what appears in the cases that I'm going to be discussing. And in your paper pack, I think you've got a little blue folder, you've got all of these slides. So I'm not going to go through each of them. I'm not going to point the pointer at them, whatever one has to do. But I'm going to talk about two of the central technology and construction court cases in the UK over the last decade. Walter Lilly and Mackay, and Vivergo and Redhall. And both of them are central to a consideration under English and Welsh common law of how to approach a construction law case. And what I'm going to do is, instead of using the slides, which Tiffany has sweated blood on the further iterations that I've prepared, correcting them, instead of going through the slides, what I'm going to do, and I hope it's helpful, is to focus on how the judge approaches his decision-making process in a construction law case. And perhaps we'll be able to compare and contrast the English common law approach with how you guys do it down here, guys and girls. And the two cases that I'm focusing on, Walter Lilly and Mackay, are cases which in the Bible, my Bible, are dealt with in the preface on pages 20 and 21, for those who can still read Roman numerals. And the Mackay case is a decision of Mr. Justice Aikenhead, Robert Aikenhead. Bertie was my head of chambers for 15 years before he went to the bench. And in appearing in front of him in the Walter Lilly case were three counsel, also from my old chambers. And sadly, they did not prevail. In the Vivergo case, one of the three counsel who did not prevail in Walter Lilly appeared again with two other counsel, again from my old chambers, in front of Vivian Ramsey, Mr. Justice Ramsey as he then was, Sir Vivian as he now is, traveling the world, arbitrating massive disputes. And on that occasion, they did prevail. So it's 1-1, for those of you who enjoy soccer. Somebody told me an interesting statistic the other day, which is that of the 7.5 billion people in the world, 2.5 live within jurisdictions which apply the common law. And so, although these cases aren't directly applicable here in terms of binding precedent, what I hope you'll find is that they do give some guidance that can be used by way of not precedent, but by way of assistance and persuasion. And what happened in the Walter Lilly case, if I could just borrow the book back. Oh, no, I've got it. What happened was three very rich guys bought a site in London for about 15 million quid, which used to be a telephone exchange. And on this site in the Boltons, which is a rather ritzy end of town, which I don't visit very often, they decided they would build three mega properties with underground car parks and swimming pools and gyms and cinemas and libraries. And Bertie described to me his site view when he went to see Mr. Mackay's property, where in the library, the bookshelves were covered in leather. And the entire house was so full of kitsch that he couldn't believe that it was worth the 15 million quid that it cost to build. But by way of postscript to this dispute that I'm going to talk to you about, in the Evening Standard on the 9th of April 2015, I spotted a report which described Mr. Mackay's unfortunate case, which he lost against his contractors, and described the figures. They bought the site for 13 million, sorry. They constructed on the site for 15 million. And in December 2014, one of the three houses was sold to a Bermuda registered company for 51.17 million, with stamp duty of 7.6 million and an annual tax on enveloped dwellings of 218,000. So even after paying his legal team 10 million quid, Mr. Mackay still made a tidy profit. So what's Mackay about? Well, it's got everything. It's got extensions of time. It's got relevant events under the JCT contract, and it's got criticality and delay analysis, and it's got it in spades. The judgment, which is available on Bailey, which is the interwebby site for cases in England and Wales, it's 2012 England and Wales High Court 1773 TCC. It's 660 paragraphs. Lord knows how long it took Bertie, but I think the case alone was 32,000 pages of documentation, lasted 16 days. The expert bundles were 33 in number, totaling some 11,000 pages, and the parties spent 9 to 10 million quid by way of costs. Mr. Mackay did not cover himself in glory. He was a rather aggressive chappie and was prone to sending emails saying things like, his neighbor, Mrs. West, was avaricious and jealous and needed an effing good slapping. And Mr. Justice Aikenhead is a man who is not prone to the use of swear words. And on page, paragraph 87, he records, sorry, somebody else might have to read this out for me. Mr. Mackay was not helping to keep the temperature down. There was an exchange of emails between him and Mr. Howie. Mr. Howie's responses were polite and restrained. Mr. Mackay's remarks included, "Guess what? When I've forgotten about you in a year's time, enjoying my 100 million quid home, or sailing on one of my 40-meter yachts, you'll still be trying to wind up some other poor unsuspecting customer with your brand of mediocrity, a sad loser, gaining your kicks and being irritating. Suggest a new career as a traffic warden might be ideal. At least it wouldn't involve lying. Oh no, little guys like you, throws his weight around, big chip on your shoulder, you were surely bullied at school. Or is it the fact that your little Victorian 1,800 square foot cottage in Pulborough can fit into my dining room?" You couldn't make this up. Or perhaps the fact that when he bought it in 2003, the cost was the same as my defective veneer. I'll bet you lord it in the pub over those neighbours of yours in the cheap semis. You're a chippy little man. You cost my company a fortune. You're such a loser, I'm going to enjoy finishing you off over the summer. Sorry about the pub. You probably bored them into closing too. 50 this year, midlife crisis as well. Nearest to a Ferrari you'll ever get is a toy one. What I find so difficult about you and your company is that you're really in the crap. You're trying to jam me all the time. This has been a sad chapter in my life. I won't, however, allow you to continue to take the piss. My middle name is Relentless. I've got the money and anger at this point to push on and make sure that you have to deliver or get punished for not delivering. I don't want to have to fight for this, but trust me, I will never give up if you don't start to change your attitude. Never underestimate me. So we can decide to have a change of attitude, or we can continue like this. I've got council's opinion, and over the summer, unless we sort it out, it'll cost you 120k in lads. Mr. Justice Aikenhead's assessment of the witnesses. Mr. Mackay qualified initially as a barrister. He's an extremely wealthy man, a bit like Vaughan. Now worth, it said, over 100 million rand. I've formed the view that he is and has been, for a long time, angry. Much of his anger has originated in his mounting frustration when matters didn't go as he'd hoped. I found him to be an unsatisfactory witness. From my observations, I've formed the view that he has lost nearly all sense of objectivity in relation to this development, and I consider that he simply doesn't understand why, given the amount of money which he spent, the house isn't perfect or exactly as he and his wife wanted. His attitude has almost become in the nature of a vendetta against Walter Lilly. Although I didn't find him to be dishonest, he was at least careless with the truth. In a number of respects. I found him a most unconvincing witness, his objectivity having gone. I think that he has now convinced himself of the truth of certain matters, such as those relating to these issues, such that although he believes that he's right, he's obviously not. Mrs. Mackay, his wife, Bertie was less than complimentary about Mrs. Mackay and her taste in interior decor, but she had a degree practicing as a solicitor and a law degree, and practiced as a solicitor for 8 years. She didn't admit that until cross-examination. However, she was frank, and I had no reason to doubt her honesty. So, what's he done there? He's assessed the evidence, he's weighed it up, the factual evidence, and he's preferred the witnesses for the claimant contractor to the witnesses for the employer who was the defendant. And that's how English judges stuff you. They make findings of fact on the documents or on the evidence that's adduced in front of them, and they weigh it up and they explain to the reader in a logical way why it is that a lying and rude man is not to be preferred to somebody who is straight and honest and comes over well. So, when you're coaching your witnesses for the next hearing in front of an arbitrator or judge, remember Mr. Mackay. Make sure that when you're doing your seminars and talking to contractors and so forth, and project managers and so forth, that they don't litter their emails with the F word and the C word unless it's a nice F word or a nice C word. Then we turn to the delay experts. As for the delay experts, Mr. Robinson, my mate Ian, and Dr. Aldridge, don't know him, I preferred Mr. Robinson in almost every respect. He, broadly, logically, and conventionally, adopted the approach of establishing critical delay by reference to the logical sequence of events which marked the longest path through the project. in my definition section, which was previously written by Keith Pickervance, we used that definition back through the first four editions, and that definition has been cited judicially in at least three continents. Dr. Aldridge accepted that this was generally the way to calculate delay. But in the difficult circumstances facing both experts, by reason of the absence of any usable contemporaneous program from early 2007 onwards, I think Ewan was talking about the importance of ongoing programs, as-built programs, and so forth, Mr. Robinson adopted a much more objective approach to his expert analysis, whilst Dr. Aldridge proceeded on a much more subjective approach. He accepted this, and I return to this later. Dr. Aldridge's report also, in some respects, almost reads simply as a suggestion to the court that the claimant hasn't proved its case. An example is the opening words. Walter Lilly's case does not stack up. His report is littered with this type of report that WLC has failed to prove or demonstrate this or that or to make out its case. It's not for an expert to suggest this type of thing. He proceeds on an obvious logical misapprehension that if works are finished before PC, they cannot have delayed completion. The most significant matters preventing PC led him to adopting, in many respects, a subjective approach to what his client thought was subjective. He then does a similar destruction job on the architectural experts. And in relation to quantum experts, he was disappointed with Mr. Pontin, although an experienced expert, I felt was trying too hard to reduce the delay and other quantum heads to an insignificant level. Whether he felt subconsciously pressurized by Mr. Mackay or not, I cannot say. But his arguments were reduced to scraping the barrel in some respects, such as suggesting that WLC hadn't demonstrated any loss in expense attributable to plot C alone. This was absurd, because it must follow that if there was, as here, almost 30 months delay, some time and costs must have been incurred in consequence. And that obviously has a cost. Some time and resources, sorry. He endorsed a totally artificial calculation to demonstrate that the contractor had recovered all its prelims on the three units. So what's he done there? He's done a similar analysis, weighing up the two sides of the evidence, and he makes his judgment unassailable, because he says these are the deficiencies in one expert and his evidence, and these are the sufficiencies in the other, and that's what I prefer. So when it goes on appeal, the Court of Appeal laughs at counsel who is wheeled in to try to get an appeal off the ground, because Bertie has stuffed them. And that's what judges do. They stuff you. And if you're on the stuffing side, it hurts. So make sure that you don't write your expert's report for them. Make sure that they're happy with expressing their opinion. Because it's their opinion. They are on the spot. And Keith Pickervance, now sitting in the Turks and Caicos Islands in retirement, was on the end of this. He had his career nearly ruined because his clients told him what their case was. They gave him the documents in support. They refused to pay him to look at any other documents or the other side's witness statements or any other information. And he stated these assumptions. He stated the constrictions on his report, in his report, and the judge still stuffed him. He should, said the judge, have looked objectively at all the evidence, because otherwise he was just a hired gun. And judges don't like hired guns. Extension of time. It's first necessary what the contract says, to consider what the contract says.
and requires. We need to know what actually happened. How the court or arbitrator makes that decision must be based on the evidence, both actual and factual. And he looks at the law, and I think in the paper or in the slides, you've got all the references to Balfour Beatty and Henry Boot and De Beers and Abu Dhabi and blah, blah, blah. The test, he says, is primarily a causation one. It therefore follows that although of persuasive weight, the City Inn case in Scotland is inapplicable within this jurisdiction. What's that all about? In Mackay and in the cases which I've just made very quick reference to, what the English courts have said is that you have to follow a very clear causative line. In order to prove an extension of time, you have to find the contractual relevant event and how that impacted on the completion date. It's all about causation, the C word. In Scotland, in City Inn, Lord Drummond Young in the Court of Session Outer House. I still don't understand how the court system works north of the border, and since they'll be independent quite soon, it probably doesn't matter. But what Lord Drummond Young did, along with his other merry men, they were once described to me as the Y Back Brigade, and I didn't press further about why that was. But what he did was said, well, look, what you should do is apportion the A word. You should take what the contract says, and you should look at relevant events. And if there's a contractor fault delay, and there's an employer fault delay, the contractor shouldn't be entitled to a full extension of time. You should give him the extension of time which relates to the proportion to which his delay is taken over by the employer delay. And that's where apportionment comes in. Robert Aikenhead follows the trad English and Welsh line and says, if you've got a relevant event which entitles the contractor to an extension of time, then to that extent, he should be relieved from any obligation to pay liquidated damages. And that's the great debate about, do we follow the Scottish line or do we follow the English and Welsh line? So that's City Inn. It's all in the paper. There's Lord Drummond Young with his Y back and the five principles. Is there a relevant event which is likely to cause or has caused delay as a result of which completion of the work is likely to be or has been delayed? Apply some common sense, do some reality checking. If it's just a couple of switches on the bathroom or the toilet roll holder, then clearly it's not a significant cause. The decision maker then has discretion as to the choice and use of evidence. And I've shown you how Mr. Mackay and his merry men got stuffed. And is the cause dominant? If the cause is dominant, you're entitled to an extension. And in case of concurrent events, neither of which is dominant, is the discretion of the decision maker is to apportion the delay by applying the principles of fairness and reasonableness. I'm not going to talk about Mirant, City Inn, and the allocation of responsibility by expert witnesses of opinion. It's all in my book, and you can happily fall asleep to it if you so wish. I'm not going to talk about time at large and the prevention principle. The points are there in the paper which you've got in your little folders. But that was Mr. Justice Jackson, now in the Court of Appeal. I'm not going to talk about notice as a condition precedent, but notices, and again, Ewan was talking about the importance of getting your notices in and how they're approached in South African law. In the UK, and this again was Outer House of Court of Session north of the border, they applied very strictly the black letter law, and they said that if you didn't comply with the notice provisions, then you weren't entitled to whatever you wanted. And that's a cautionary tale which can probably, again, be of persuasive effect. Costain and Haswell is a useful case about valuing delay for loss and expense and damages for prolongation. I'm not going to talk about that. And so that's what we've already covered on Walter Lilly. And global and total loss claims. Mr. Justice Aikenhead said, "These aren't terms of art or statutorily defined terms. What is commonly referred to as a global claim is a contractor's claim which identifies numerous potential or actual causes of delay and or disruption, a total cost on the job, a net payment from the employer, and a claim for the balance between costs and payment, which is attributed without more and by inference to the causes of delay and disruption relied upon." Common lawyers hate global claims, particularly black letter lawyers, because what they say is, come on, most contractors are going to be able to tie in a specific loss and expense to a specific delaying event, a prolongation, or a specific disruptive event. And this comes back to the F word, the facts, the facts, the facts. You've got to inculcate your clients and your project managers and your guys on the ground, record, 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 photographs, site diaries, poor records, whatever. Make sure that you've got a documentary trail which shows that when these guys went to do the kitchen fittings in flat 123, they couldn't because the first fixed pipework wasn't ready, and so they had to come back to the site office and be reassigned. And that's disruption. They had to not do what they were intending to do, waste time going back to the other side of site, waste time while they were reassigned, and then go somewhere else to do something else. And you can measure that. You can record that. And if you do that, some contractors came to me the other day in conference, and they didn't know I'd written the book, but when I put it on the table in front of them, they said, can we show you our records? I said, yeah, sure. So they got out their computer, powered it up, and they had like a schedule showing each relevant event, what contractual provision was relied upon, what the event was, and what effect that had, and what cost that had. And in these days of BIM, I don't know what BIM impact there's been down here. In these days of electronic recording, you can shove it all into your laptop or on your iPad, on your phone. I've got all sorts of appies or whatever they're called, and I've got no idea what they do, but what my interns do is record how much time I spend on any particular case, and it's all on the iPhone. And at the end of the month, instead of scraping around and trying to put together the timesheets, I just print out what's on the iPhone, or somebody does it for me because I'm a technophobe. So that was global claims. Valuation. How are we doing on time, Bill? Is it lunchtime yet? right. Let's get on to head office overheads and profit. Who's used one of the formulae, Emden or Hudson, in the presentation of claims? Ewan, the only man in the room to have used a formulaic approach to proof of causation, to proof of prolongation or overhead and profit claims. They're still allowed. Bertie Aikenhead in Lilly allowed them. And they have to prove on the balance of probabilities, which of course is the civil standard of proof, that that loss was suffered. So they have to show that if they hadn't had that extension of time or that disruption, they would have been out there in the field doing other projects and making a profit. And in Lilly, in Mackay, Robert Aiken had allowed a partial global claim because he said that in the circumstances of that case where there were no clear records, it was impossible for the contractor to show the cause and effect that I was talking about earlier. And in those circumstances, it was fair and reasonable because they showed that they'd suffered loss on other projects to award recovery in that case. So, we move on from Bertie Aikenhead to Viv the Spiv, which is what we all used to call him before he went to the High Court, and then we had to call him My Lord. By the way, Vivian and I are good mates, don't get me wrong. We were founder editors of Construction Law Journal, published by Sweet and Maxwell, which is not only still going strong, but will be the subject matter of a special issue on the basis of the papers for this conference. So, in Vivergo, the bull issue was all about whether the contractor had been in repudiatory breach in failing to provide an updated program. And if they were in repudiatory breach, had the employer served the relevant notice in order to determine under the contract? And if they hadn't served the relevant notice, or it wasn't in the correct form, was that conduct in itself repudiatory? And if that were the case, what was the contractor's remedy? This is time and time again the scenario which appears. You have to get your notices right. And if you don't get your notices right, the other F word applies to you. Because you will have repudiated the contract. So don't leave the contract in the drawer, as Ewan was talking about. Get it out. What does it say about a trigger notice? How far in advance should that be issued before the termination notice? And what are the terms that are required? What do the two notices need to show? And in Vivergo, which is 2013 EWHC 4030 TCC, Viv does a similar demolition job. He prefers one expert over another. Vivergo also relies on Mr. Crossley's evidence that the absence of an up-to-date program some 3 months after it was requested would have had an adverse impact on the contract manager's ability to manage the contract works. Would have meant it was impossible to gauge whether Redhall was in fact using its reasonable endeavours to perform its obligations and would have an adverse impact on the contract manager's ability to manage and to coordinate the entire project, in particular with respect to the E and I contractors. How often has that been the scenario on your jobs? If the program isn't properly updated, you can't manage the project. And that's why in the UK we've just had come into effect in June the governmental requirement that building information modelling up to level 2 be incorporated in every contract involving government or local government contracts. So you can use BIM not only to do the modelling of what the building looks like and to avoid clashes between mechanical services and so forth and the underlying structure, but you can incorporate in a BIM model resources modelling, time modelling and cost modelling. And if you use that, it's all there, ready for your forensic expert at the end of the day. He goes on to consider the law and whether the breach of contractual obligation is material or not. And then he talks about using reasonable endeavors and finds, in summary, the need for the revised program was not some mere unimportant obligation. Rather, it went to an important aspect of the project, the time of completion, and on a project such as the present, that was relevant not only as a matter of management of Red Hall's works, but the entire project. It wasn't made less important by the existence of the Rev 3 program, the draft Rev 4 programs in later, or the look ahead programs. Taking into account all the circumstances relating to the breach of the Clause 13.5 obligation, including the scope, nature, and extent of the breach, the circumstances in which the breach arose, the effect of the breach on ACCA Vivergo, the alternative programs and remedies available, I consider that Redhall's breach of Clause 13.5 was material in the context of the provisions of the termination clause in this case. Now, if you had been counsel for Redhall with that judgment being read out extempore, with no preceding knowledge of what comes later, you would think that the F word applied once again. You were up or down the Swanee, whatever one goes. But no, because then he goes to look at the obligation to proceed regularly and diligently. And what Redhall did was, when the trigger notice came in, they updated their program. They complied with the notice of breach that was being alleged against them, and they did what they was told. And if you do what you're told in relation to a trigger notice, the other side can't then pull the trigger based upon the original breach, because you've remedied the breach. And if you've remedied the breach, there ain't no breach left. And so when Vivergo sought to issue the second notice terminating the contract for breach of the contract based upon the original notice, the court said, you're bonkers. You're absolutely stark, raving bonkers, because the breach has been remedied. If the breach has been remedied, no continuing breach, no entitled to terminate. If no entitlement to terminate, a purported termination based upon a remedied breach is repudiatory. Therefore, you, Mr. Employer, were in repudiatory breach of contract. And therefore, lucky guys, Redhall, were able to recover, despite their initial programming breaches and the absence of the correct approach to notices, led to Vivian finding in favour of Redhall. And it's a good judgment. It talks about logic links and critical path. So those of you who are into all of those technical aspects, Vivian recites all things about completion date, rate of progress, man hours, productivity, and blah, blah, blah. And summary and conclusions. Redhall is entitled to an extension of 15 working days to the overall completion date, is entitled to an extension of 12 days to the milestone dates. Redhall was failing to proceed regularly and diligently with the contract works on such and such a date. Redhall was in material breach of its obligation to provide a program. They gave a notice and they remedied the breach, and therefore Redhall wasn't in repudiatory breach, but Vivergo was, and therefore lost. 521 paragraphs. It's magic. I recommend it. Where's my flasher? Let's talk a little bit about opinion evidence. In my book at pages 968 through 979, I consider expert evidence and recite the number of cases where judicial pronouncements have ruined opinion evidence or opinion experts' careers, because they don't have a right of reply. They've produced their report, they've stated their opinion, and they go into the court under the common law system, owing a duty not to the client who pays them. They're not a hired gun. They, the courts have found, and the civil procedure rules and decisions like Icaria and Reefer have held, that the duty of the expert witness is owed to the decision maker, to the judge, to the court, to the arbitrator. And in those circumstances, if you're not open to consideration of all of the evidence, to an objective approach to that evidence, then the judgment is going to come down against you. And obviously, you have to have expertise in the relevant field and knowledge. And one of the areas of criticism that judges apply, apart from what I was talking about earlier, where assumptions are made and stated which don't reflect the evidentiary position, what an expert has to show is this openness, this objectivity and awareness of what the other side's case is as well as your own side's case, and that balancing exercise, weighing up the strengths and weaknesses of both sides and helping the tribunal to reach its decision. It will come as no surprise to you that a recent Court of Appeal decision spends three paragraphs dissecting a sentence about cats and dogs. It's an amazing decision. It's called Andrew Wood and Short Term Direct Limited, 2015 EWCA Civil Division 839. And this case was all about a share division agreement. And the claim was worth 2.432 mil UK, GB. And it's back to Ewan and what he was talking about, the importance of contract drafting. There was a comma missing. A comma missing which crucially determined whether one party got 2.43 or the other party got it. And that single comma, on that comma and the absence of it, the case turned. And where do cats and dogs come into this? In this connection, paragraph 37, Mr. Twigger, QC, proffered an analysis based on the relevant likelihood of different meanings of a hypothetical predicate. Big words. Suppose, he said, that X says, I like cats and dogs which are black and fluffy. That might mean A, I like cats and dogs which, in each case, are both black and fluffy. Or B, I like cats of any kind and dogs that are black and fluffy. But it is most unlikely to mean I like cats which are fluffy and dogs which are black and fluffy. Statements about black and fluffy cats and dogs differ in form, context, and content from the wording in the present case and may be said to owe more to grammarian ingenuity, big words, than commercial interpretation. Nevertheless, it appears to me that Mr. Twigger's analogy provides a small pointer, but no more, toward the interpretation which I favour. It tallies with my less hypothetical view that all three requirements identified in the above paragraph apply to the obligation to indemnify against each of two categories of loss. It's the comma. I'm going to come back to the morals of the story when I try to do a bit of crystal ball gazing. And perhaps I'll do that now before ending on a high note, hopefully. The title of the speech, which I've lost, requires not only a retrospective analysis, but also a prospective viewpoint. And I wanted to pick up on a few other things that Ewan talked about before the coffee break. As to, on the international stage, international arbitration, dispute boards, and so forth, what are the likely big-ticket numbers, big-ticket issues going forward? And it seems to me that they are five in number. Rubbing my gypsy Rosa Burr trend spotting. What are they called? Crystal ball. One, the courts, whether it be here in South Africa, the Technology and Construction Court in London and elsewhere in the UK, the Swiss Supreme Court, the Court of Appeal in Singapore, and the High Court, and various other judicial levels of judicial decision making across the globe, tend towards the enforcement of dispute board and other adjudicatory decisions. And that's got to be a good thing. It's got to be a good thing because under the UK adjudication provisions, under the Housing Grants Act, which Ian Duncan Wallace used to call the Hugh Grant Act, and that was because employers found it difficult to swallow. those of you younger than 25 will have no idea what that's all about, and I will explain it to you in the bar later. What was her name? Something Brown, wasn't it? Wasn't it in a car park in LA? So we went from having a 2.5 to 3 year time lag from the start of litigation or arbitration proceedings in the UK when I was a baby barrister. The first arbitration hearing I went to was at the Gresham Club in the city, and we argued for 4 weeks about less than 100 grand, and the costs overtopped that. And we were in front of Sir Norman Royce, who was the president of the RIBA, who was an absolute stickler. He wouldn't have stood for any of this morning's frivolity. And at the end of it, the client spent shed loads of cash and had a wonderful award, but the cash was overtopped by what the award was hugely overtopped by what it cost to achieve. And what the Hugh Grant Act has done is brought in a requirement for any construction dispute to be resolved within 28 days. And subject to certain exemptions, I think similar ones to the South African exemptions, oil and gas and pipelines for some reason, the lobby managed to exclude those from the Construction Act. But if you have a compliant construction contract in the UK, either party is entitled at any time to adjudicate. And that adjudicator is statutorily obliged to make his decision or her decision within 28 days or 42 days if the referring party grants an extension. Or if both parties, and I've had 100-day adjudications, if both parties say, look, we've got 25 lever arch files on each side, you can't possibly decide this in a month. We need 6 months or 3 months or whatever. You can agree to set aside the statutory entitlement or obligation, and you can extend time. And what happened was that the statute did not provide for how that decision was to be enforced. And so judge-made law in the Technology and Construction Court has resulted in a raft of decisions where the judges said, look, what the Latham report said was, cash flow is the lifeblood of the industry. The reason for the bringing into effect of adjudication was to ensure that that lifeblood flowed down the arteries, down from the employer to the contractor, and down from the contractor to the subbies. And if that's right, you can't wait 3 years because you're going to die. The 28-day decision has to be enforced. It's subject to it being pro tem, because the underlying contract will then provide for a further adjudicatory decision by an arbitrator or a judge. But in the meantime, if the adjudicator decides that money is due, thou shalt pay. And the only reasons to prevent enforcement are, one, breach of natural justice, and two, what's the other one? Jurisdiction. Out with jurisdiction. Two interesting decisions recently. An adjudicator who shall remain nameless, but I think has crossed these shores, was asked by counsel, how many times have you decided adjudication decisions for the other side in the last 5 years?
I'm not prepared to divulge this information. Please proceed.
They write to him, and then they find out that there's another judgment. And on the face of the judgment, the adjudicator has made a decision where he's been appointed by the other side. So they've got one. And in that judgment, they found that there's a five more. 25% of his income, 25% of the cases in the previous 5 years had been where he had made decisions for the other side. And he refused to divulge that. How bonkers. And so the judge asked him to provide a witness statement. And he refused to provide the information. Bonkers. 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 Bingham. Sorry. And the decision wasn't enforced. Breach of natural justice. You were biased. You were biased in favor of the other side because 25% of your income came from them. Jurisdiction. I've just done a series of three Tech Bar and TEXA, the Technology and Construction Bar and Technology and Construction Solicitors Association adjudications. And there's this sort of knee-jerk. Everybody says, it's outside your jurisdiction. And you say, no, it's not. There's a contract. It's a construction contract. There's a dispute. I've got jurisdiction. And I got ruder and ruder with these people. They were saying, no crystallized dispute. But then they said, this is the subject matter of two previous adjudicators' decisions. Sorry? How can you have one without the other? If there were two previous adjudicators' decisions, there must have been disputes. They must have crystallized. Maybe you may say that the present dispute has already been decided, but you can't say that there's no crystallized dispute. Oh, by the way, if you look at the notice to refer, they've referred a completely different dispute. Read what the words say. Oh, and the other thing he said, I'm not going to tell you the name of the Mishkondareya partner who ran this arrant rubbish, but he wrote to me and he said, the words of the scheme for construction contracts require the referral notice to be served on the adjudicator at the same time as service upon, no, not served, require to be sent to the adjudicator at the same time as they are sent to the responding party. On the Monday of the 4th of July, or end of June, the referring party, having achieved my nomination and appointment by the chairman of Tech Bar, who happens to be a QC in my old chambers, who very kindly
thought about me after I had left those shores. I was appointed, I accepted my nomination and sent my acceptance and nomination, and required the referring party to send the referral notice to me on such and such a date, and to the responding party. They sent it to me by taking a hard copy to my chambers at 150 Fleet Street and delivering it to my clerk. The partner of the law firm, he didn't send a courier, he physically took the One Lever Arch file referral notice to my clerk and handed it to him on the Tuesday. No, the Monday. The same day, he sent via DX the same bundle, or a copy thereof, to the responding party. So he sent it the same day. That's what the contract says. That's what the scheme said. And the guy had recited these words, sent on the same day. They were sent on the same day. And he said, yeah, but you received yours first. I said, well, actually, it doesn't say received, it says sent. It was sent on the same day. And if it was sent, the fact that it was received by my clerk the day before it was received by you is irrelevant. And in fact, I actually received it the next day because I was too busy on the Monday and went in to collect it on the Tuesday. So I actually got it, received it, the same day as he did. And I had 5 pages telling me that I had no jurisdiction. I spent 5 hours telling him, yes, I did. And then after my terms and conditions said, each party is jointly and severally liable, and by the way, here's my email address, they sent a letter by snail mail to my clerk while he was on vacation. And in the meantime, I spent 4 more days preparing my 28-day decision for the next week, because they'd burned nearly 3 weeks on this twaddle. That letter said, both parties agree that this adjudication should no longer proceed. They'd clearly done a deal. They did a sidebar deal. And somebody agreed to pay somebody. And I sent them a bill for all that time because they hadn't sent me an effing email. So if you've got means of communication which do not entail some form of 19th century application of a stamp, bloody well use them. I had another case recently where, sorry, you and I said I wouldn't swear, but I just did. It's French. I had another case where I had 2 bunches of Muslims, and my guys were the nice Muslims, and they were employed by a nasty Muslim to build a 1.5 million block of flats down the East End. And the nasty Muslim thought it was cute to go into site meetings with his iPhone and put it under the desk and record the meetings. And he would make accusations to the nice Muslims about their failure to proceed regularly and diligently. I don't think he used those words because I don't think he could read. But so he had these transcripts. And in his notice of referral, no, it wasn't a notice of referral, it was a notice of arbitration to Mr. Peter Aberley, he cited aspects of this transcript which my clients had no idea about. And then he cited his SMS messages. And I think he terminated them by SMS. You know, he's a nice chap. You know, it's a bit like divorcing somebody by SMS. And we went before the arbitrator on a case management meeting. And he said, well, Mr. So-and-so, I'm sure Mr. Burr is going to raise any objections that he may wish to, but before he does that, can I just observe this, that if you're going to put in transcripts or you're going to put in SMS messages, you can't simply pick and choose. Mr. Burr and his clients, the nice Muslims, he didn't say that, are entitled to see the lot, because you've just taken the cherry-picked bits that suit your case. And when we got the lot, because he was forced to disclose them under common law discovery rules, we were able, or I was able, in the early hours of one morning, to put together a timeline. The timeline goes like this. Site meeting, recorded on his iPhone. He thought it was cute. He thought it was going to stuff my boys. But we found the bit where they said, please do not get in direct contact with our subcontractors. And then the transcript says, meeting ended 11:30. 11:35, SMS message to subcontractors. Would you please contract directly with me at your original contract rates, thereby avoiding the contractor's uplift of overhead and profit? 20 minutes later, after their positive response, SMS message terminating our contract. Repudiation. We won. Stupid arbitrator, though, didn't give us a very large award. So, where did I go before I went off on that frolic? Trend spotting one, pro-enforcement. The corollary to that means that courts and tribunals will be against intervening in either dispute boards or adjudications or arbitrations. We've seen, certainly in the UK, a massive support for adjudication, as I've described. We've seen massive support for party autonomy in going to arbitration. And I think we're going to see, and I just recently did an article for Construction Law International, massive judicial and arbitral support for dispute board decisions. And that leads me to the third of my crystal ball gazing, trend spotting suggestions. I think dispute boards, that their time has come. And there's been massive resistance from some employers, because they say, well, and contractors, they say, well, look, if we're going to have a dispute board, a standing dispute board, rather than an ad hoc board, it's an added cost to the contract. But what they don't realize in that simplistic approach is that that additional cost to the contract can lead to the avoidance of disputes, because dispute boards can act qua mediator and can intervene before a dispute really arises and can nip it in the bud. And if you nip disputes in the bud, you reduce costs. And the long-term effect of that means that dispute boards, standing dispute boards, are a good thing. And that's why the World Bank requires dispute boards on any World Bank procurement contract, and all of the other development banks have followed suit. And if that's the case, then a lot of infrastructure projects that we've been talking about will be caught by that requirement. So that's the third one. The fourth one is back to the expert evidence and opinion evidence. And the trend that I perceive is an internationalization of that requirement for independence and impartiality. And it's coming through IBA rules and guidelines and various other rules and guidelines, certainly in the courts in the UK and elsewhere. And so I think that hired guns are probably going to be a thing of the past, although perhaps not in the United States, although even there they're being hounded out. And I saw the wonderful judgment in the Pistorius decision, where I think it was suggested that the expert witness there had not necessarily been owing the duty to the court. And the fourth and final one is really an indicator, or it was indicated by this event, an internationalization of construction law, a borrowing of principles and themes and decisions from other jurisdictions and their use in persuasive terms in other jurisdictions where perhaps historically they weren't so prevalent. And I was talking with Vaughan the other night and with Ian. Wolfgang Breyer, who's a Rechtsanwalt in Stuttgart, and I and some others have established the International Construction Law Association. I think the website is www.iclassoc.org, and I commend it to you. We are hopeful. The inaugural meeting was in Paris back in June, and we compared and contrasted five different legal families: UK common law, North American common law, Napoleonic civil code, Germanic civil code, and Chinese law. And what we are hopeful, cross fingers, is that next year we may be able to do it in conjunction with this excellent collective wisdom. And so ICLA and those sorts of bodies, I think, are important. I wanted to end on a high note because, well, I hope it's a high note. As I mentioned earlier, I travelled down here writing the paper and the slides which I've binned. Oh, not binned, they're still valid, but I haven't spoken to them precisely, with Turkish Airlines. And I watched a number of movies, and one of them was The Jungle Book, which made me cry. And the other one, which I didn't watch, was Batman versus Superman. And Turkish Airlines kindly gave me a little bag with all of the goodies in it. And the subtitle for Batman versus Superman is Dawn of Justice. So, have we got the dawn of justice? Well, I was reading a Turkish newspaper, an English language Turkish newspaper. And all of the cases that I've been talking about are cases where there was massive delay, 30 weeks, blah, 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 extensions of time, loss and expense, all of those lovely things that are so close to our hearts as we go to adjudication, mediation, litigation, and arbitration. And I opened to page 5 of this Turkish newspaper called The Daily Sabah. The Yavuz Sultan Selim Bridge, the third bridge over the Bosphorus, was completed within a record-breaking 27-month time frame, 9 months ahead of schedule, according to Transportation, Maritime and Communications Minister Ahmed Arslan. The project, which is worth 8.5 Turkish lira, is first of its kind completed in such a time frame and could break a world record. Consisting of 8 lanes of motorway and 2 lanes of railway in the middle, the bridge is a first in the world to span a length of 59 metres and feature a tower 322 metres in height. The bridge was constructed in accordance with the build-operate-transfer model without the use of any public resources. What an inspiration to us as we consider our lunch and this afternoon further consideration of infrastructure projects. Let's hold that up as a great example. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a pleasure addressing you. I hope you've got some questions, but if not, we'll go to the bar. Thank you.